it's a real honor to be sitting in this chair, given the other folks who've sat in it today and in previous years. I'm gonna quote some of the previous speakers, and the first quote I'm gonna use is that I too shall curtail my own comments in the spirit of time today. The five of us just met in the hallway for the first time and agreed that as we approach the dinner hour and the cocktail hour, we just want to focus and offer some thoughts and some ideas and not go too deep with them. The topic is the nutrition gap. The question on the table is, how does nutrition relate to all the other topics we've been talking about today? Hunger, soil, climate change, technology, finance, disease, et cetera. And how does it do so in a very fast-changing 21st century, in a world unlike any we've ever known before, where change is happening at an accelerating pace in multiple directions at the same time, including 9+ billion people? What does nutrition have to do with all of this? In order to curtail the comments, as I said, what I'm going to do is quote a few people from earlier. I'm just going to rattle through some ideas that have come up that set the stage wonderfully so we don't have to repeat these things. In no particular order, what is invisibility and hidden hunger? How do we give rural people the resources and the tools and a sense of agency so that they can lift themselves out of poverty? There's no amount of science and technology that will achieve our goals if the social needs of the communities aren't addressed. Nutrition begins on the farm. Invest in rural youth. There's a massive youth bulge happening. We need data on human nutrition. We don't understand it. In preparation for the November FAO conference in Rome, I read recently from IFPRI that 81 countries are not able to produce just the basic statistics on the full spectrum of nutritional questions that they had hoped to gather prior to that international, major international event, because the data doesn't exist. Technology will help people choose foods that are more nutritious. We need to bring in new voices. Be proactive. It's almost a given that we need to focus on value chains. We must address health. Make money, or save time. How else are you going to achieve behavioral change, et cetera? Thank you all, previous speakers, for those quotes and those ideas. That sets the stage for my perspective on what we're discussing. Let me tip my hand at the outset in saying that when you understand nutrition and nourishment as an outcome, not as a set of inputs or ingredients in a process, but as the result, then nutrition is paramount. And it's paramount, from my perspective, both as a primary goal, but also as perhaps, to me, the most powerful integrating mechanism we have for achieving all of the other goals we've listed. In hunger, in soil, in water, in resilience to climate issues, et cetera. So that's my intro curtailed. What we have today is five practitioners, so you're also not gonna hear from a government, multilateral, or think tank representative. You're gonna hear from five different industries, each of whom think about and address and deliver and source and deliver nutrition to people in different ways. And so I appreciate Ambassador Quinn assembling this panel with the diversity that it has. You're gonna hear that diversity of perspectives. We don't know if we're gonna end up saying similar or different things. You can help us draw that conclusion. We have Kathy Pickett of the health and pharmaceuticals company Abbott. We have Navyn Salem, the founder of Edacia, which manufactures and now supplies over 6,000 metric tons of food and nutritional supplements, like Plumpy Nut, for example, targeted to alleviating various forms of malnutrition, for children under the age of 5, if I'm correct, right? We have Tom Leech from Walmart, Tom is the Senior Vice President of Global Food and Consumable Sourcing. And we have Bram Govaerts, as you just heard, a very special guest at this year's Borlaug Dialogue. And Bram works on innovations across agricultural value chains that support the development of high and sustainable yield maize and wheat production in the context of environmental gains as well. And you have me. I come from a group called Ashoka. Ashoka is the world's oldest and largest association of system-changing social entrepreneurs. We can talk more about that later. We work in 72 countries. We have a network of around 3,000 social entrepreneurs who have changed systems in society in one way or another. And all we're gonna do is each give an opening shot. We're gonna talk through a couple of questions together. If we still have time and energy, we wanna hear you fill in with questions or gaps that we've missed. So briefly, let me give you a snapshot of the Ashoka perspective and then hand it over here. Why am I here talking to you? I don't come from the field of agriculture, nutrition, health, or food. I come from the field of social entrepreneurship. And so about 5 years ago, Ashoka set out to try to find and support and draw lessons about the future from the innovations and insights of around 100 emerging social entrepreneurs in India and sub-Saharan Africa who work on or changing systems, business, social, and policy systems in rural economies. We did so. Again, happy to tell you more about that later. In addition to finding, screening, electing, and supporting them, we study them. The question is, what do you see if you look at the world's leading social entrepreneurs? What do you see in terms of patterns and insights about the future? What do you see about what the future is going to look like if your data set is entrepreneurs? The answer is nutrition. That's what we found. And that's a major focus of what we're doing now. These are, I think, the kinds of people, the social entrepreneurs, who in fact have developed enterprises and business models around the behavioral change and delivery mechanisms that have been being questioned today. So it would be really fun and interesting for anyone who's interested to take time on the side and tell you about 10 or 20 or 30 or 40 or 100 of them. Let me give you one or two examples to set context. Dale Lewis founded an organization in Zambia called Komako. It's a food company. About 10 years ago, Dale Lewis did this because he wanted to save elephants. Dale Lewis now has a food company in Zambia with a supply chain of just over 101,000 smallholder farmers. In Dale Lewis's region of eastern Zambia, where those 101,000 farmers support a total population of about 1 million people, the hunger season has ended virtually completely. Deforestation has ceased completely because desperation has gone away. Poaching of elephants has decreased 93%. And they're exporting peanut butter and soy products throughout Zambia and have initial lines of business into South Africa. Dale argues that the barrier to his expansion right now is a finance barrier, because in order for his model to work, he's got to commit pre-harvest financing to tens of thousands more farmers who are waiting to sign up for his supply chain operations. The market demand is there, but it's a different way of operating, and the financial markets aren't used to it. It's an example. We have Steve Collins of Ireland, who operates primarily in refugee camps throughout sub-Saharan Africa, who's innovated, much like Salem here, around bioavailable nutritional supplements that are correlating, now that massive data sets in big data analysis is available, are correlating with faster, more effective rates of recovery from chronic and acute malnutrition. Because of attention to micronutrient deficiencies in ways that more traditional food aid programs weren't addressing. We have Genevieve Moreau of Belgium, a pharmacist who has first documented the nutritional carrying capacity from soils through farming into food harvesting, transport, production, cooking, and consumption, and then use that now as to create a set of protocols that citizens in major metropolitan centers throughout Western Europe are using to lobby their municipal governments to put nourishment and nutritional outcomes at the forefront of their policymaking agenda, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. I had a chart, thank you. Just briefly, there's a chart I want to show you that simplifies this, and it's my wrap-up, which is to say that what Ashok has done, if you can imagine 200 or 300 little dots on this diagram, is piece together the value basis that many of the world's leading social entrepreneurs are using around which to form their profit or nonprofit enterprises, either in these different boxes, at the intersection of these boxes, and some of them across all of these boxes. And by observing this action, which is happening in the field at the scale, like I said, of tens or hundreds of thousands of people, what we're observing is really the formation of this bottom line, the social and economic demand that turns the scientific nutrient chain or the scientific nutrient cycle that we're all familiar with back into a cycle that, in these locations at least, seems to offer not just the actual impact in these places and the promise at a much larger scale to wrap the social economic mechanisms back into the enterprises so that the nutrient, extractive nutrient chain and pollution becomes a cycle again that can put back in the hands of millions and millions and millions of change-making people around the world in the context of a 21st century that is rapidly changing in ways that none of us understand at this point in time. Thanks for listening through that. I'm going to stop, hand it to Kathy, and then go down the line and just pause and say, what's your definition of nutrition? And who does it serve?
Sure, and thanks again for the invitation to be here. I'm Kathy Pickus. I oversee corporate responsibility and our philanthropy at Abbott. And if many of you know, Abbott is a global healthcare company with a very significant nutrition business. And one of my favorite things to do in the context of social responsibility is to migrate over to where the scientists sit and to learn from them, not just what they do every day to ensure that the products that our customers buy from us and depend on having the highest of quality and the best and most advanced nutrition is accessed not just by those who can afford the highest, most innovative products, but how we can capture this expertise and direct it towards initiatives that are being done to serve different needs in various parts of the world in terms of nutrition. And so I guess when you think of a business like Abbott, we have all kinds of experts that have the capability of lending their expertise to make transformative impacts in terms of how people are accessing nutrition. So we do some things in a philanthropic sense with that expertise. But more and more, we're finding that where some critical inputs can take place is in our day-to-day operations, through our value chain. And I've heard a lot of people talk about that today, like the private sector has a role. Well, the private sector does have a role. And just listening to my peers from DuPont and from Monsanto, we're actively engaging in operating not just sustainably and responsibly, but inclusively. And so how we think about our value chains going forward, and I've got a senior group of nutrition business leaders in India right now dedicating a new nutrition facility. And one of the most exciting things that we're doing is we're taking some of our value chain expertise and we're building out capability with smallholder farmers in India. So all of that about talk about what's happened in previous panels, about what's possible, it's happening. It's happening with Nestle, it's happening with Abbott in a way that will not just deliver the highest quality of products, but it will grow economies in those ecosystems as you talk about in your diagram. So it's very exciting to talk about this transformation that talks not just about how we can do our business more responsibly and sustainably, but the inclusive part about thinking about innovations, product innovations that are affordable, that really are directed at some gaps that we'll talk about in a little bit in terms of the area of nutrition and how it can make a really great long-term sustainable impact on on the health and well-being of populations everywhere.
Thank you. Navyn?
Is anyone else getting hungry talking about food for the last 4 hours without a break? So, well, I brought some if you guys, if anyone can't wait till cocktail hour. But so thanks for having me. Nutrition to me once meant, how do I feed my own kids? I have 4 young daughters, and that's a constant battle in our house. But about 7 years ago, I looked at it in a completely different way and was visiting in Tanzania, where my father, my grandfather, and great-grandparents came from, and visiting a malnutrition ward in Dar es Salaam and seeing in this ward children who couldn't pick up their heads, children who could barely breathe, open their eyes, and see that someone's there to visit them. And to then see children actually die from a lack of food and nutrition, and hear the mother who's in such grief from a loss of her child, completely changed how I viewed malnutrition and nutrition in general. And that experience alone was enough to make me decide to dedicate my life to this very simple idea of trying to deliver micronutrients to children so that not only they have the ability to survive, but also so that we can build their brains and bodies so that they can thrive, they can do well in school, and they can be productive members of society as they get older. And so it was that one experience that, actually, after I visited that malnutrition ward, I went to visit a factory. Strange, maybe, correlation, but this factory was making mosquito nets, and there was a line out the door of people. And I said, what are those people out there waiting for? And they said, they're waiting for jobs. And when I went into this factory, there were 3,000 women working in this factory making mosquito nets. And I thought, this is a brilliant business model. They're creating jobs, and they just happen to be solving a global health challenge at the same time. And so I thought, maybe I could use my business background to do something similar, but in this way, address malnutrition, address agriculture, job creation, and that whole triangle together to be able to address malnutrition in Tanzania. So I set up a factory there to employ local Tanzanians and local peanuts and all the inputs that we could get. And then a few years after that, decided that we needed a factory in the US as well, because there wasn't at the time a nonprofit food aid manufacturing company that could work with USAID and work with our government here to look at how we can respond from the United States. Having a factory here allows us to be engaged in research and development, in innovation, and new products and ideas. And so what we do 24 hours a day is make a fortified peanut butter that was just here. That's basically peanuts, milk powder, vitamins, and minerals. And it's proven to completely rehabilitate a severely malnourished child in an average of 7 to 8 weeks. And we are producing this around the clock, mostly in response to emergencies. And while that's not a very long-term approach, and it maybe doesn't have to do with agriculture and research and that whole thought of value chains and things like that, there is such a need for emergencies at the same time. We've got wars going on everywhere in Syria, Central African Republic, Sudan. We have droughts. You know, there's so much instability that while what we're talking about here in agriculture is so important, sometimes we can't wait and we have to intervene in emergencies. And so what we're dealing with mostly is the acute malnutrition. We're always trying to push more towards prevention, and we do a lot of work in that area, but a lot of why we're running around the clock with no notice is really in response to these emergencies. So we work with UNICEF, World Food Program, and USAID, who help distribute these products called ready-to-use therapeutic foods in about 42 countries since we opened 4 years ago. We've reached about 2.5 million children in that time frame, And that's really only scratching the surface.
Thank you, Navyn. Navyn has introduced one an important thread through all the conversations I think we've had today, and certainly as you talk about nutrition, which is the distinction between severe, acute, short-term, macronutrient, malnutrition, starvation, physical hunger that you feel, versus what is sometimes now called hidden hunger, long-term micronutrient and mineral deficiencies, which aren't even that well understood, but again, because of the power of big data, are at least beginning to be correlated with higher rates of disease recovery, higher levels of performance in school, higher levels of productivity in companies, and also with very serious implications for the intergenerational implications of babies whose mothers were malnourished when those babies were in the womb and during the first few weeks or months of life. There's a difference here between feeding hungry people so their stomachs feel full and they've basically recovered the energy they need to function, and their and society's long-term physical and cognitive development and ability to function economically. And so we get into the question of what's the relevance of all the technologies and approaches and of nature's own capacity to generate nourishment as a short-term solution or as a long-term model of fostering people and communities that nourish themselves around the planet. Thanks. Tom from Walmart.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. I've sat through the last couple sessions, and this is one of our biggest challenges. I would agree with what others are saying. At Walmart, you know, we serve about 250 million customers every week in 27 countries. And so the ability to be able to source and move products efficiently, to be able to serve our customers, is a business imperative. It's our survival as a company. It's also probably the most important challenge that we're facing. So as we think about our role, there's lots of things I could talk about, but we see ourselves as a company that can, I guess, leverage who we are, maybe to a degree the power of the PO, to bring people together to have these types of conversations. When we think about what we're trying to do, we always talk about bringing safe, affordable, sustainable, nutritious foods to our customers in all those countries. And it's, you know, so as we think about this, just last week, as a matter of fact, we held a summit in Bentonville on sustainability. It was led by Doug McMillan, our new president and CEO. And we had folks from all different areas of the business. And we talked about specific objectives. And at Walmart, we're very clear that we do well what we measure. So we're very big on measuring. And so we set measures and objectives and goals on everything. And we hold ourselves accountable, and we communicate back how we're tracking against those measurements. And I can't get into all the details just in the interest of time, but there were about 10 suppliers who Walmart has worked with who made announcements around commitments. And in aggregate, those commitments impact about 10 million acres of land where they're working with farmers on trying to have more efficient agricultural practices. A lot of it is around reducing the greenhouse gas emissions. And so we've set specific objectives, and we've done this for several years now, around water, around yields, around GHG. And so we're holding ourselves accountable to those. Now, you know, how do we define nutrition? I mean, that's a big question, obviously. I think a few things I'd like to just mention before I pass it over is, you know, when I think about nutrition, I think there's several things we're doing and that we will continue to do and that we need to do more of. So one area would be just purely around product and ingredients. And we, you know, we've set goals on, one of my areas of responsibility is private brands. within Walmart US, and we set very specific targeted goals around reduction on sugar, reduction of sodium, reduction of or elimination of trans fats. So we set specific goals on our private brands, which is something we have more control over, around those areas, and we're making great progress on those, and we will continue to stretch our goals in those respects. Another area that I'd like to comment on is just healthier options, nutritional options. And we believe it's our role is to try to find supply chain efficiencies and pass those cost savings on to our customers, because I think one of the things in nutrition is affordability. And so what we're trying to do, and I think Walmart does a fairly good job of trying to find supply chain efficiencies and working with whether it be the growers or the manufacturers. And so we're very focused around that. And you know, as we measure, we believe we pass on in the neighborhood of just of $1 billion of savings to our customers in produce alone every year.
Thanks, Tom. I'm sorry, Bram, let me make just two observations I have on this. One is Tom has introduced another dimension then of what we mean by nutrition, which is this question of overconsumption. And depending on the science you follow, it's a question of the ratio between the micronutrients and the macronutrients that you consume. And the struggle that almost every country on the planet faces now with burgeoning obesity crises and the chronic illnesses that come with that, in part related to the problem that in order to achieve sufficient micronutrient and trace element intake, we're overconsuming calories. This is a nutritional problem. And it, again, begs this question of acute, immediate, short-term undernutrition, overnutrition of primary macronutrients, or the spread of minerals and trace elements that we all need, but we don't understand scientifically very well yet at this point. The other thing I wanted to observe is that, so all we need basically is 36 more Walmarts to serve 9 billion people, right? Or we need some other approaches to be thrown into the mix, right?
Let me just comment on that. So I do believe that this is not a company fight. This is not an NGO fight. I mean, this is everybody sitting in this room and those who've probably already left to happy hour. This is where we feel the power of this is where we get together with others and we talk about it and we brainstorm. But what I'm very clear on is we have to set goals and we have to be extremely diligent on measuring ourselves against those goals. And what I worry about when I attend things like this is I worry that we can have great conversation, but that's just conversation. So how do we think about piloting something and then when it's successful, scaling it? And I've spent a lot of my time in the last few months on specifically around, we have several pilots that we're just initiating around with some partners around water and those things I mentioned before, yields, technology and produce. And we've set specific pilots, and the whole thing is around at what point do you determine that it's successful enough to scale it, and then scaling it quickly. And in the Walmart world, it's, you know, obviously we're about scale and efficiencies, and so we're looking at ways of doing things that are good and reduce costs, and we can scale.
Thank you.
Sorry.
No problem.
Bram?
Yeah, actually, when I got the invitation for this panel, my first reaction was, this is going to be a piece of cake, no? Because it's about nutrition, so this is going to be about how to get the right amount of fertilizer to the plant, and that plant is happy and grows. And then I started to prepare myself for the session, and all of a sudden it was not that kind of nutrition. So then I got confused, and I kept reading and thinking about it, and then I came to the conclusion that it's exactly about that kind of nutrition, because it's about soil fertility. And actually that this nutrition you guys are talking about can become a driver. Because in the end, working for the International Maize and Wheat Improvement System, the vision or the goal is to develop sustainable maize wheat-based production systems. And the nutrition can be a driver, especially for the sustainability part. Because if you look at a smallholder farmer who has to make sure that he produces enough food for the family, we want that farmer to have a diverse diet. But from an agronomic point of view, we want that farmer probably to do conservation agriculture, so we have fertile soils, so that we can leave some of the residues, but also especially to do crop rotation or crop diversification. So there, they already come together. But then if you look at a farmer that actually tries to sell some of the wheat on the market, it's clear that the wheat breeding effort takes into account from the beginning of the whole thinking, from the beginning of how are we gonna make sure that our research is responding to a need, is actually solving a limiting factor that farmer is gonna have to live with when he's managing that production system. Quality becomes extremely important. So breeders in CIMID are very worried from the beginning to make sure that those wheat varieties, that those have the right quality aspect so that they can actually go to the market. But then it was exactly also what happened a couple of months ago. I was very surprised when I asked that one of the most important bakers to draw its value chain, its supply chain. And that supply chain started where the millers started. So actually the farmer was of that supply chain. And that becomes very interesting because then we lose that driver effect. So part of what you're talking about, going to scale, part of how can we make that those innovations happen, part of how can we actually provoke that change is by integrating that back into that value chain thinking. And that actually you, Walmart, would be worried about how is that wheat that is in my bread actually produced. Maybe can we think about some sustainable bread, or maybe think about some sustainable cookie that actually takes into account what happened with those trace gases, not only when you transported the cookies from the factory to your shops, but actually when the wheat was produced that goes into those cookies. And then you have the third part, where actually we want a self-sufficient farmer to not only feed the family, but also the surplus, the extra he or she generates, to be able to sell that on the working market. So then it becomes actually more of a driver because then he or she's making sure that the local community or further away has nutritious maize and wheat that can be used maybe in a fancy restaurant in New York by buying blue tortillas from land races produced in sustainable practices in Mexico.
Thank you so much. And Bram has done a wonderful wrap back to then what Ashoka means, what Ashoka observes the entrepreneurs of the world doing around what we call the nutrient value chain, right? It's like this pause for a minute, wait a minute, you mean that, and we do mean that, better nourished people who are performing more effectively in their economies, in their schools, and the infant babies are succeeding in life, correlate with the quality of the soil in which your food was grown. Absolutely. That's what we're seeing, and we're seeing it at the scale of hundreds of thousands, or in the Zambia case, at least 1 million people in this one valley. I'm gonna take, we only have 5 minutes. A couple people need to run to the airport, and we're talking about cookies and bread and things that we all wanna nourish ourselves with. So I see one gentleman waiting patiently at the mic, and one lady. Let's take your two comments or questions. I'm gonna add a third one of my own. We'll have a quick set of wrap-up comments, just sort of tackling those, and then hopefully with this provocation, we can continue the nourishment conversation over dinner and beyond. Sir?
Thank you very much. My name is Chris Goldthwaite. I wear several hats, but I'm asking the question on behalf of the American Peanut Council. We work to promote the use of ready-to-use therapeutic food and ready-to-use supplementary food. And we do this regardless of whether we're supporting the American producers like Edesia or producers in developing countries that use local peanuts for these products. My question actually is for Mr. Leech, and it goes to some discussions that we've been having with Edesia and other American producers about whether or not there is a role for the ready-to-use supplementary foods not targeted as they have been up until now at people that really cannot afford them, that have to use that are in fact the beneficiaries of NGOs and governments and international organizations that hand out these foods. But whether for people that are a little bit further up in the income chain, there would be a use for them as commercial products. And I'd like to ask Mr. Leech whether he would see a market for products in his stores for those stores that are in emerging markets and developing countries for a commercial product that is essentially a nutritional supplement similar to a ready-to-use supplementary food.
Great. Thank you. Thanks.
Hi, my name.
You want to tackle it now? Go for it.
Pardon me?
I was going to take the next question and then roll on down.
Oh, do you
want
to do that? Okay.
My name is Penny Anderson. I work for Mercy Corps, a humanitarian organization. And thank you to the panel. I think it's so important to address nutrition at sessions like this. Earlier today, one of the speakers was talking about how increased agricultural productivity can have a very powerful impact on improving nutrition. And that certainly is true, but not always. There have also been cases where there's been increased productivity, increased income, and there's been seen a reduction in nutrition and food security, perhaps because smallholder farmers are switching to cash crops or they're growing something more diverse, but they're selling it and they're buying the staples once again. So my question is, what is the best way to ensure that smallholder farmers are able to address not only perhaps increased yields, but also increased nutrition and addressing micronutrient deficiencies as well as the caloric needs? Thank you.
Thank you. We only have 3 minutes, so I'm going to have to ask you to hold. Thank you, because I want to toss my last provocation in as well, which is I'd love to hear any comments or thoughts from you or all of you over the next day or two. One of the things we're pretty sure from the view of social entrepreneurs that we're going to be able to do in the next few years, not tomorrow, but not too far in the distant future, is to get a readout of your personal level of nourishment. Using big data, using very advanced spectronomical or other approaches to be able to tell you how nourishing some piece of food is that you're holding in your hand or how nourished you are as a person. In the Ashoka world, we believe that this is gonna drive immense demand for regenerative farming, conservation agriculture, soil enhancement, which will also lead to, as we all know, carbon capture, improved water cycles, resilience in the face of climate change, et cetera. For you all, if you want to address it now, for all of you to ponder, the question is, how's your world going to change? How's your business going to change when you can actually measure not the nutritional inputs to a product, but the nourishment outcomes that come from consuming that product? Tom, why don't we lead off with you, because you got a specific question. You can react to any of the three.
Well, first of all, for the first question I was asked around nutritional supplements, it's hard for me to answer in a general way. What I would always say is that, I mean, anybody who's walked into Walmart sees that we carry a lot of SKUs, a lot of products, and the customer is our boss. That's the way we see it. And if a customer needs something or wants something, then we make it available to them. And I have no doubt that there are markets, there's actually even places inside of our country here where there's a need for probably more nutritional supplemental products. And so it's kind of a generic answer, but there's no doubt to me that there's a need by certain customers, whether it be in our own country here or in other countries around the world. And you know, I think our challenge, and I mentioned it earlier around communication, is, you know, not all customers who need nutrition go out and spend their money on that. And so we have to help educate people as to how do they afford nutritious products, because often what happens is those who are more economically challenged tend to spend their money on things that are less nutritious. So that's why I emphasize affordability of produce and other types of products, is we have to be able to make products that are nutritious and healthier available so that people can afford them. Well, I'll stop.
Other responses to what you?
A little bit about where the opportunity resides. And one of the things that we're finding is that long gone are the days where we can just manufacture something and put it on the shelf. There's an absolute demand to report on, the traceability of every ingredient, as well as a responsibility to deliver products that meet these needs and make them affordable. And one of the things that we're finding is that our typical partnerships have been completely transformed based on where the demand is coming from in terms of emerging markets or developing markets. We're finding that our typical historic partners in philanthropy are coming to us and saying, we no longer want to have a grant from the foundation, we want to be your business partner. We want to make sure that we're a part of the delivery mechanism, not only so that we can access some good nutrition, but we can also make a living while doing that. We also need to make sure that we're delivering against the expectation in terms of what the sustainability profile of those products are as well. So it gets very complicated.
Yep. Navyn, did you have any other?
Just in closing, I think there's, as we look to feed 9 billion people, there's really an opportunity here to link agriculture and nutrition as much as we can. And really the importance of delivering micronutrients to the 2 billion people who don't have access to them right now. And more of that education and awareness about how this lifts an entire country and raises their GDP by several percentage points is such a critical need. And, our part is to continually be innovating and looking for specific targeted solutions for specific populations, not in any way a silver bullet, but looking at all the different, whether they're pregnant mothers, school children, children under the age of 2, they all need different interventions at different stages of their lives. And we've got to find creative, cost-effective, attractive solutions to treating those people in those critical stages of life.
I would just add that, and related to the question of the second person, it's because it's we need to decide it's not only about productivity. It's not only about increasing the volume, if that's your definition of productivity. From the beginning, in that whole analysis, quality, post-harvest technologies, soil health, soil fertility need to be included in the whole design of that, what we would call productivity gain. And going a little bit back to your comment on big data, In a sense, it's getting easier and easier to generate data. So it's getting easier and easier to have big data. But it's getting more and more complicated to turn those big data, one, into something meaningful, into information that actually supports decision-taking at the right time. And number two, that decision-taking and that information is available in an equal manner and an equal access to everybody who needs it along that value chain. So now that this trend is happening, I think that we have the responsibility as another element in sustainability to make sure from the beginning that equal access is guaranteed. And how does this whole discussion changes? I think it brings very clearly forward that we are starting to focus on the nexus between soil, water, energy, agriculture, and food. And that's on that within the research that's really looking at those processes are going to be able to make a difference.
Super. Thank you, Bram. Everybody, thank you very much for being here. I think the takeaway is interesting. It's complex. It's the science, the technologies, the infrastructure that underlie it are important, but they're still not going to reach 9 billion people if you don't somehow get all of these resources and ideas into the hands of a lot more people on planet Earth who see it as their own place to seize the problem, to craft local solutions, to make change. That's really what Ashoka is all about, and our focus right now in this realm is on putting this idea of the nutrient value chain and how change-making people up and down that chain can benefit, putting it in the hands of millions of people around the planet. letting them write on the science and the analytics and the infrastructure and the government policies that many of you are responsible for developing, thank you, but now putting it in the hands of multiple diverse, powerful groups of people in the world. So, thanks everybody, and thanks to the World Food Prize for giving us this time today.